I did tell you again, and I'll mention it again, we are international. We were there in Exeter. Before that, we've been in Nigeria. We've been in Jerusalem. We're now going to go across the Atlantic over to Washington, D.C. And no, it's not Trump. You'll be glad to hear. But if he was going to give a speech, it'd probably be the best speech on Al-Quds, the best speech Al-Quds could do. But no, we're going to go over to Imam Muhammad al-Asi in Washington. And Imam Muhammad al-Asi is an Islamic scholar. And he's also written a tafsir of the Quran. And I was very fortunate and lucky. I don't know if he remembers, but I barged into his house in Washington in 1994. With Imam Abu Halim Musa, and had dinner with him. So it's great to see him. I've been seeing him for the past 20, 30 odd years without trying to tell you how old I am. But a great, great servant to the cause of struggle, to the cause of standing up for truth, peace, love, and justice. So Raza, I'll hand it over to you to take it on with Imam Muhammad al-Asi.
I mean, before I welcome Imam al-Asi to this, I mean, to add to the credentials, there are many credentials, but I'll just mention a couple. Imam al-Asi has been banned from traveling to Saudi Arabia. And I think that ban has now been extended by the UK. So he can't actually travel to the UK, the mother of all colonizers. You know, so much for freedoms of speech, and so much for freedom of association, etc., that the West trumps on about. And so, under normal circumstances, Imam al-Asi would not have actually been able to join us on the rallying for Quds Day and standing for Quds Day in London. So, in the current scenario, in the current situation, we've been allowed an opportunity online. To tell the British establishment where to go on this one and have the benefit of Imam al-Asi's participation on this online rally. So, assalamu alaikum, Imam al-Asi. How are you?
Alhamdulillah, wa alaikum as-salam. Everything is fine over here. Ramadan Kareem. May Allah accept this Ramadan, our devotion, our efforts, our everlasting struggle for justice. May all of this be accepted in these high and holy days. Thank you for having me on.
Some people think of Palestine as something that is far away, especially when we're living in the West and don't actually link the struggle that is going on in Palestine with our own issues and what's actually going on here and how it's linked up. What would you say to those people that don't take that on in that way, don't have that fervor for it, or don't think of it as something in the background?
Well, yeah, that's that type of thought or those types of ideas live on, thrive on the relative political ignorance that's in the public mind. If there was just enough accurate information circulating in our daily thoughts, then we would know that the issue of Palestine is a central issue. It sort of concentrates religious, political, ideological, historical, demographic, philosophical threads into what has become almost the central issue of the whole world. Many places in the world, there are other areas in the world that are troubled areas. There is population dislocations in many other parts of the world. But what stands the Palestinian issue out, and I think the previous speaker has alluded to this, is that the mainstream media doesn't have any problem speaking about these other issues, more or less. But the mainstream media has a complex when it comes to speaking about the issue of Palestine. It's sort of off limits. And then if there are some brave souls in the mainstream media who find it within their conscience to knock on the door of the Palestinian issue, they are relieved of their responsibilities. In harsher words, they're fired. And so the Palestinian issue becomes like an orphan issue. There's sort of no one out there who's willing to come to the support of a population that has been dealt probably one of the worst politics translated into military aggression and colonization. I've heard the word colonization and I mean occupation, and I have difficulty with that word. It sort of lends some type of availability to the Zionists. I think we should be as brave enough as to say this is a colonization of the Holy Land from whichever angle you approach it, whether you're a Muslim, a Christian, or a Jew. This is a colonization of the Holy Land. There are European colonizers who hijacked the Jewish religion and tried to explain it in humanitarian Zionist terms at the expense of creating another humanitarian problem. And so my request is try to replace the word occupation with the word colonization. So at least in our choice of words, we have more punch to them, more fuel in them than the otherwise defensive words or imposed words on us. I think that sort of, and along these lines, what comes to my mind at this moment, and there are other issues, of course, you know, there's talk about the right of return. And that's also another one of these catchphrases that is tucked into diplomatic language. And we should get rid of this right of return and go on the mental offensive and replace it with the right to stay. There are certainly some of the Jewish faith who have the freedom to settle in the Holy Land, but there are definitely many more others who don't have the right to be there. So our concern in the future should be on trying to figure out those of the Jewish faith who have been hijacked by Zionism and sort them out from the Zionist culprits and criminal war criminals that have to be defeated and have to withdraw by force, because that's the only option that is left for them by their own choice, and begin to speak about the right of those who can stay in Palestine. That's where we are, because the momentum is changing. It's no longer that they have the Zionists with their military capabilities and with their military programs with the United States military and all of this. And they used to scare people. I remember when I was in Beirut back in the late 60s, early 70s, when there were even some psychologically defeated individuals. Some of them may have been Lebanese, some of them may have been Palestinians, who thought...
In here, Imam Asi, I mean, you said the momentum has changed. I want to take that a little bit further. You know, not every Jew is a Zionist, and not every Zionist is a Jew. You know, today we've got Zionist Jews, Zionist Christians, of which you have a strong lobby in the US. And also, we've got Zionist Muslims. For example, the mayor of London, Sadiq Khan, is a Zionist, and our ex-Home Office Minister, Sajid Javid, is a Zionist, although he's not quite sure sometimes whether he's a Muslim or not. People say that as a result of this expansion of the Zionist Zionization of the political space and more people being Zionized, how can you say that this is changing, and what would you say to that narrative?
Yes, I would look at this with two layers. We're speaking about two categories of people. There's definitely in the elitist segment of the world, meaning in the governmental establishments, the upper crust of all of that, or most of it, is either Zionist to the core, as is the case in the United States, as is the case in Britain, and in other such quote-unquote advanced countries. And then there are Zionists who are sort of going with the trend. If they see the wind blow in the Zionist direction, they will definitely blow with it. If they see the wind blowing against the Zionist direction, they will have nothing to do with it. So this is the elitist classes of the world. But then on the other hand, we have the popular classes of the world, the people's classes of the world. And they are to be found all in the whole world. They are the majority of the world. And there is now, I think, in my reading of world events, there is a conscientization of the peoples of the world against the elites of the world. Now, they don't, you know, depending on, you know, whether you're on the political left or you're on the political right, and this is where much of this awareness is beginning to thrive on what is called the political right or the political left. And depending on the terminology and the language and the choice of words, if we bypass all of that, we recognize that there is a shift, a very significant shift in the world. You take just our current affairs. There were before this COVID-19, there were demonstrations almost in all continents, massive demonstrations in all continents of the world. And this is another expression, just a symptom of this conscientizing of the peoples of the world. And eventually this people's movement is seeking justice. And the pursuit of that justice in and of itself is de-Zionizing the elites.
And on that note, I'm going to have to interject here. I'm afraid, I think it's always great to hear from you, and I wish I could hear you for longer. Unfortunately, the time of this rally is confined. So I'd like to thank you, and I hope inshallah we'll be able to meet again in the future, probably not in the UK, but some other country, no doubt, in the future. Thank you so much for joining us. I'll hand you back over to Nazim.
Shukran. Thank you so much for your wonderful contribution there. And it's always a pleasure to see you. And as Raza said, we hope to see you somewhere. And I don't know if they'll let me back in Washington, but I'd love to come and have dinner with you again, inshallah. JazakAllah khair. Thank you.